Good afternoon. I am Irini Saragboulis, Associate Professor and Coordinator of Interprofessional Education at the USF Taneja College of Pharmacy. On behalf of the USF Health Simulation Consortium, welcome to today's webinar. The purpose of this Lunch and Learn series is to discuss best practices in simulation and available resources. Throughout the webinar, feel free to type in your questions within the comments. The question and answer session will be moderated by Ms. Juanita Medina Jimenez. Our distinguished guest today is Dr. Chelsea Renfro, who will share her experiences and the road to integrating simulation within pharmacy education. Dr. Renfro is an assistant professor in the Department of Clinical Pharmacy and Translational Science and coordinator of simulation-based education at the University of Tennessee Health Science Center, College of Pharmacy. She received her PharmD degree from East Tennessee State University Bill Gatton College of Pharmacy. Dr. Renfro completed a PGY1 pharmacy practice residency at the University of North Carolina Eshelman School of Pharmacy with a focus in ambulatory care and transitions of care. Her interest in simulation began during her postdoctoral fellowship in community pharmacy while she was at UNC. She is the founding chair of the Society for Simulation and Healthcare Pharmacy Affinity Group, West Region Director at Large for the Tennessee Simulation Alliance, and co-leader of the Tennessee Interprofessional Practice and Education Consortium Working Group on Simulation-Based Instruction. Dr. Renfro's interests within simulation include curriculum design and implementation. Through her role within simulation at the college, she has worked to build a very robust simulation-based education program, which includes the use of simulation for practicing pharmacists and students as well. Warmest of welcomes, Dr. Renfro, and thank you for joining us today.
Well, thank you so much, Ernie, for that warm welcome. Let me go ahead and make sure that my slides are working. So first off, I wanted to say how excited I am to be here with you all virtually, but I'm even more excited to come out and see you all in July for the SimOps conference. So I'll actually be down there giving a presentation, kind of building on some of the things I'm talking about here related to operation considerations for pharmacy simulation. So I'm super excited to come down and see your all's campus. So I'll see you all in July in person, my first in-person conference since we had COVID. Since COVID's happened, I think since IMSH 2020 was my last in-person conference. So super excited to start getting out and being in person. So today, like Irini mentioned, I'm going to be talking about the road to integrating simulation in pharmacy education. And I wanted to share a little piece with you all that's not in my background, but I think it gives background for why I'm so passionate about making sure that we're following best practices when we're integrating simulation into pharmacy education. So whenever I was in pharmacy school, simulation had just started becoming more and more popular, and we had used it. They were starting to use standardized patients. We used a little bit of mannequins, but we had a formal assessment. So it was a summative assessment. And we walked in, and we didn't get much of a pre-brief, but we walked in and I had a faculty member in there, and I didn't realize that. I thought it was going to be an SP. I panicked. It wasn't my best performance ever. So with that, I was like, I'm never going to do simulation ever again. I have no desire to ever participate in that. And I think the universe has a funny way of telling us whenever you say something like that, that's probably what you're going to wind up doing for the rest of your life. So now I'm very passionate about simulation-based education. So I just wanted to share that story. And I always share it with my students to kind of normalize that it is okay to get a little bit anxious when you are doing a simulation, but we're trying everything in our power to make sure that it is a safe environment for you to practice in. But I just wanted to share that before we go ahead and get started. So today's objectives, we have pretty much what I want to do is walk through why is simulation training important for pharmacy education, and also talk about some simulation operation considerations for whenever you're designing and implementing pharmacy simulations. I'll talk a little bit about this later on, but one of the reasons why I wanted to bring that in here is because I've talked to a lot of simulation center directors, and they'll ask me, we've never done anything for pharmacy before. What are some things that we should take into consideration? So that's why I wanted to weave that into this presentation today. And then lastly, I'll share some simulations that we've done at the University of Tennessee Health Science Center. And I'll share one that's pharmacy specific, and then I'll share one that's an interprofessional education simulation. It's actually kind of more around gamification. But I want to share that with you all so you can summarize some lessons learned that we've had at the University of Tennessee. So first off, I wanted to start by asking the question, what does a pharmacist do? And the reason why I ask this is because I'm commonly asked whenever I attend simulation conferences or trainings, how do you actually use simulation to train pharmacy students? I'll start sharing all of the different things that we do to train our pharmacy students using simulation. And after I'm done, the other person will typically say, wow, I had no clue that pharmacists did all of that. I typically think of a pharmacist as filling prescriptions in the community pharmacy setting or verifying orders in the hospital setting. I didn't realize they did all of that. So first off, I wanted to, before I share with you different, and I don't know if you're familiar with the entrustable professional activities, but that's something that I've found is a very easy way to communicate what a pharmacist does. So before I share that with you all, I wanted to get your all's, ask you all a question. So what does a pharmacist do? So with that, I'm going to use a different technology if it will work with me today. We tried it out and it worked. Okay, here we go. So this technology is called Poll Everywhere, and I use it a lot whenever I'm giving presentations so I can engage the audience, especially in this webinar format, since I can't see you all. So there are two different ways that you can engage. One way is through using the web. So if you're in front of your computer or you have your phone, you can pull up pollev.com. And whenever it asks you the username for the person to join the poll, you can type in C Renfro. And that's one way that you can respond. The other way, if you're not, don't have access to a computer or you don't have a smartphone, that you can also join by text. So you can text C Renfro to 37607. And then you can text in your response after it. I think it'll come back with a little text message that has the question to it. So what this will do is put together a word cloud to show kind of all of the different things that people think about whenever they're thinking about what a pharmacist does. So I'll give you all a couple seconds or a couple minutes to get familiar with the technology. So I'm seeing a lot about medications, dosing, that's great. Drugs, interactions, yep, that's something that we always try to make sure that our students are very aware of. What are different interactions? And of course you can't memorize all of the interactions, but knowing what are the most common ones or the most important ones that you need to know off the top of your head, and then knowing where can you go to find the rest of them. Great. It's great that I'm seeing that. Kinetics. Yes. Yes. Whenever I worked as Irini mentioned, my background is in ambulatory care. So I trained in family medicine clinics. So I did a lot with patients from, 6 years old, working with them to help manage their asthma, working with the physician on that, all the way up to we had older adults where I did a lot with fall risk. So whenever I was in the inpatient setting, we would do some with kinetics. So yeah, responding to codes. Exactly right. So I'm glad to see that you all are looking at other things that pharmacists do other than just filling medication. So I think that that's great. I'm going to go ahead and close that one down and go to the next part of the presentation. So with that, pharmacists are medication experts, and they're responsible to patients for achieving the best medication treatment outcomes, at the same time, assuring that the treatment is cost effective and it's safe. So pharmacists working within healthcare teams advise other healthcare professionals on the proper dose, availability, side effects, and monitoring parameters for the effective medication usage. In some settings, they work with collaborative practice agreements to manage patients' drug therapy. So whenever I was working in the clinic setting, I had a collaborative practice agreement for certain medications. It wasn't all encompassing, but certain medications. And then I'd meet with the provider once a week to kind of go over what medications that I made for that past week for their patients. Pharmacists may also work in other environments where medications are used, or there's medication therapy needs to be evaluated as part of the patient's care. You could see that in, and these are just common ones, but they're not, it's not all encompassing. So community-based settings. So that could be community pharmacy or an ambulatory care setting, health systems. So think about acute care. There's long-term care, managed care, other different ways that pharmacists can get involved. They can also have extra training through residencies or fellowships to specialize in different areas such as critical care, pediatrics, oncology, and family medicine. So what I'm showing here on the screen is the core entrustable professional activities that whenever pharmacy students graduate, and these are for new pharmacy graduates, not students who have completed residency training or fellowship training. They might be look a little bit different or a little bit more advanced, since that gives you, 3 to 5 years of training. We want to think about the patient care provider domain. And I know looking and talking to other professions, they have something very similar to this. So thinking about collecting that information, then analyzing that information, establishing patient care center goals, and implementing a care plan. And while you're doing that with collaboration of all healthcare providers. And it's not just always medicine and nursing. We try to engage our students with a lot of other professionals. So for example, this summer I'm doing teaching an interprofessional class, and we're working with speech pathologists, audiologists, nutritionists, or I think it's dietitians, and then we're also working with optometry students, so we can understand how pharmacists can even work with those professions. And then lastly, follow up and monitor a care plan. But why I wanted to bring this up was before integrating pharmacy learners into your simulations, it's really helpful to know the activities and tasks the pharmacy learners are taught during their education. And like I said, EPAs are a great way to do this because they're also observable. That's one thing that whenever we started integrating entrustable professional activities into our curriculum, we were looking at this and some people are like, oh, well, we can give a test, or we can give an exam, or quiz, or even a patient case. And the patient case kind of gets to it. But when you look at all of this, these are things that you need to observe and watch the student do. And some things that you want, of course, they'll learn on rotations, but you want to make sure that before they go on rotations, that they know how to do some of these things. So that's where simulation in our curriculum really comes into play. We want to make sure before they go out on their introductory rotations, that they know how to do certain things. Before they go out on their advanced pharmacy practice rotations or experiences, you might hear them be called APPEs. Those rotations, you want to make sure that they know how to do certain things. So with that, I'm going to show you the next slide here. So this is really the pharmacist patient care process, and you can see the EPAs that we talked about previously for the patient care provider domain. Really elaborate on this, but this is the pharmacist patient care process that was adopted or developed by the Joint Commission of Pharmacy Practitioners. So with that, there were many different pharmacy organizations that came together to put together this process for what pharmacists do whenever they take care of a patient. And why I'm wanting to mention this and share this with you is because it's not dependent on a certain setting. This isn't only for ambulatory care, or it's not only for inpatient. It applies to what pharmacists should be doing all across all settings whenever they're working and taking care of patients. So as if you're wanting to integrate pharmacists or pharmacy students into your interprofessional education events, that way you know, okay, well, if we're assessing the patient and then developing a plan, pharmacy students, they do that too. They might just do it or focus on a different thing. They might focus more on the medication side or that piece of it. So we frequently use simulation to teach and assess collaboration as a member of an interprofessional care team. So one of the entrustable professional activities for new pharmacy graduates is really focused on how can you collaborate as a member of an interprofessional care team. We often use, and I know there are other pharmacy schools across the nation that use this, but we often use team steps. And I don't know if you're familiar with team steps or not, but it was developed by AHRQ to really put an emphasis on how the team can work together to improve patient safety. So we do have several simulations that we use that are interprofessional. We also have some activities that really aren't simulations, but focusing on how to integrate team steps into these simulations and make sure our students are aware of this before they go out on rotations to make sure that they can collaborate as a member of the interprofessional team, or that they have these tools to be able to. We also have the population health promoter domain. So a couple that I really wanted to point out here was identifying patients at risk for prevalent diseases in a population. So a lot of times, whenever the past couple of slides I talked about, they were what's the process for taking care of one patient? But sometimes we're looking at patients as a whole or a population as a whole and using population health management to look at, okay, well, we have this list of patients here. We have these who are non-adherent, to really kind of figure out and develop interventions to meet that set of patients. So while we think about the patient individually, we also have developed simulations to think about patient populations as a whole. And then we have, these are the last EPAs that I want to talk to you all about. The other EPAs, they really focus around information masters and making sure that you can educate patients and professional colleagues, use evidence-based information to advance patient care, thinking about practice manager, and then lastly, self-developer. And I wanted to point out one thing here. So whenever you're looking at all of the EPAs, as you can see, there's only one, and it's under the practice manager domain, that really focuses on fulfilling an actual medication order. So there are so many other things that go into that than just dispensing medications. And that's why I wanted to share this with you, because I've talked to so many different directors that haven't really had any interaction with simulation, or even some physicians, and they're like, well, we really want to integrate pharmacists. They're such a valid part of the team. And I'm getting super excited. And then they're like, but we don't have any simulations that have medication orders. So that's why I like sharing this, to see all the different things that pharmacists can do. So the next step for this presentation is I want to talk about accreditation standards. So as you all know, and I'm sure that you all are aware, all accredited health profession programs require satisfactory completion of a minimum number of clinical hours to ensure graduates are practice ready in a real world setting. However, accreditation bodies vary among health disciplines, how they define and quantify simulation in a couple different, in various ways. So Irini and I have actually, we've been working on a book chapter together and with the help of some other people. And part of that book chapter, we looked at accreditation standards for different healthcare professions, ranging from, just thinking of some off the top of my head, athletic training, dentistry, physical therapy, social work, to see what their accreditation standards stated in the terms of simulation. Because of course, how the accreditation standards lay out simulation, that might guide how your profession actually implements it into certain curriculum. And it was interesting to see the differences among the professions and how they quantify and define simulation. So for the next activity then, or engagement that I wanted to have for everybody was, so how do your professions accreditation standards, what do they state regarding the use of simulation? And this one isn't a word cloud format. It's more just kind of whenever you respond, it'll pull up on the screen. And let me make sure this is activated. Yep, we're activated. So you can join, like I said, two different ways. It should be very similar to how you joined for the first question. I'll give you all a couple minutes. I know whenever you're typing things in, it might take a little bit of time. So you have a couple of responses. Yep, so you must use simulation, but not specific. That was one thing that I found whenever I was putting together the table for the book chapter, is a lot of standards, they mention simulation, but there wasn't specific guidance around things that you specifically had to do. And I'll get to this on the next slide, but it was really interesting to see. And if you work with pharmacists, you'll quickly know how detail-oriented that some pharmacists can be. And it's really interesting talking to the simulation staff at our sim center here, and it's the Center for Healthcare Improvement and Patient Simulation, or CHIPS, and it's always interesting to say, yes, we can definitely tell when we have pharmacy students, because they're so detail focused, either whether it's about the patient or the rubric that they're being assessed on. So yeah, so a lot of places they'll provide definitions, but there's not clear guidance. So I did want to share specifically what the pharmacy or the accreditation standards of pharmacy education says about simulation. Because as I mentioned previously, the standards really guide, or how your profession has the standards laid out and how they integrate simulation, really guides how you're going to use simulation. So in colleges and schools of pharmacy, they state that simulated experiences, they can be, they don't have to be, but they can be incorporated into the introductory pharmacy practice experiences. And that can be similar to pharmacist delivered patient care situations, but it shouldn't be more than 60 hours. So whenever you're looking at that, we have a total of 300 hours that are related to the IPPE or the introductory pharmacy practice experiences. So they can't be more than 60. And that's really where we house a lot of our simulation time, is in that time we count it towards that. And then colleges, they also state, and I found this to be interesting whenever I was looking at all the different professions, is colleges and schools of pharmacy need to have a sufficient number of faculty to address the simulation teaching needs, as well as have access to educational simulation capabilities. So I think it's great. Fortunately, here at UT, we have access to our Center for Healthcare Safety, or Center for Healthcare Improvement and Patient Safety. It's, or Patient Simulation, CHIPS. I'll just refer to it as CHIPS from here on out. It's a mouthful to say. But we're fortunate enough to have access to their facility, but several pharmacy schools, especially even the one that I attended, the pharmacy school and where I did my training, they don't have access to a full center that's at the campus level. They might be working with the College of Medicine, or even some schools or colleges of pharmacy don't have access to a simulation center. So they will try to work with other programs to find ways to deliver simulations in their program if they're using them. But I think it's great that whenever, and I'll talk about this on the next slide, but with SSH, whenever I started getting involved in SSH and I set for my CHSE, it was really great to be able to get more guidance and have more development on how to build a simulation program. But that is something that we address in our accreditation standards. And lastly, the one thing I wanted to highlight and really talk about was the use of performance-based assessments. So summative simulations, some people might use OSCEs as well. OSCEs aren't always, as you all know, simulation, but that's one thing. Whenever you see pharmacy use simulation, they might lean a little bit more towards using it for those summative assessments and not use it as much for formative assessments or formative simulations, just for the fact that in our standards, that is one thing. Whenever they talk about assessments, they do specifically mention using simulation for performance-based assessments. So that's one thing that I noticed whenever I'll talk to some people, is they'll focus more on simulation for that part. And then some other healthcare professions, I've talked to some of the instructors and faculty, and they're like, well, we only use simulation formative, we don't really use it for summative. So that's something to keep in mind too, is in pharmacy, we do lean a little bit more towards the summative simulation assessments. So lastly, before we have a break to see if there are any questions in the chat, I wanted to talk about the Society for Simulation and Healthcare. And I was introduced to the Society for Simulation and Healthcare when I joined the faculty at University of Tennessee Health Science Center. And I had the opportunity to work with the late Dr. Chad Epps. And I don't know if any of you all know Dr. Epps, but he was just, or have had the opportunity to work with him. He was he just loves to mentor people. So he kind of took me under his wing whenever I joined the faculty at the University of Tennessee. And I had simulation experience prior to this, but he really took me under his wing, and he was talking about the NAXL standards for best practice. We talked about the ASPE standards for using SPs, because whenever we use simulation, a lot of times in the simulations that we have developed, SPs are really, we use more SPs than we do mannequins or anything really virtual. reality or anything like that. So he, and I was like, well, yeah, I've heard about them, but I don't really know much about them. So he kind of took me under his wing and he said, well, Chelsea, you really need to join the Society for Simulation of Healthcare. And this was all in 2017. And I said, well, okay, I can do that. So I get online, and at that point, I think he was the immediate past president for SSH. So I get online and I'm like, okay, well, let me register for or become a member of SSH. And it gives me the opportunity to sign up for an affinity group, SIGs, or sections. And I looked at that and I was like, well, there's no pharmacy affinity group. There's no pharmacy section. There's no pharmacy SIG. So I pop in his office and I was like, Chad, there's no pharmacy affinity group here. It's like, how am I supposed to get involved in SSH? And he looks at me and he said, well, there would be if you created it, Chelsea. And I said, well, no, Chad, you don't understand. I'm an assistant professor. You know, simulation is very new to me. I did it during my fellowship and a little bit during my residency. And he said, well, no, Chelsea, there would be a pharmacy affinity group if you created it. So he really took me under his wing and helped me put together and connected me with different people at SSH. And we built and developed the pharmacy affinity group. And it's not just for pharmacy educators. And I wanted to put that out here. It's really for, we have a lot of different healthcare professions that are involved. We have simulation center directors, simulation center sim ops people that are involved. And I think we actually might have a couple SPs involved in it, but to really understand how that they can best, and the reason why they join is so they can understand how to best use simulation for pharmacy education. So our goals are to increase pharmacy simulation both nationally and internationally, because really simulation's taken off in the past 10 years in pharmacy education, maybe even the past 8. To also share knowledge and experiences surrounding the integration of pharmacy simulation or simulation in pharmacy education, because a lot of pharmacy educators are using simulation but aren't aware of best practices related to simulation. Also, active participation in research and other scholarly activities, because as you know, for us to be able to move the profession forward, we need to be doing research around what are those best practices. Identify and develop profession-specific resources for training and assessment. So that's something that whenever I know our affinity group will always, we have an education working group, and we'll try to figure out, okay, well, what are goals that or needs that you all have of the members to figure out what kind of maybe webinars can we put together or sessions could we submit at SSH. We also try to put sessions together at our own pharmacy education conferences. And then lastly, participate in the development of interprofessional simulation training and showing how pharmacists can be involved in interprofessional education. So I just wanted to share this, the pharmacy affinity group, and let you all know that it exists. And we would love to have you all as members, have you get involved. This is my last year. So at the IMSH 2022, I'll be stepping down as chair. I finished my 4 years as chair. So I'll be stepping down from that, but I'm super, super excited to get involved in other ways with the Pharmacy Affinity Group and keep moving simulation forward. But please, please, please look at it. We'd love to have you involved with the group. So with that, I'm going to see if there are any specific questions in the chat. I'm seeing one that's asking about advice. And I can get to some advice maybe later in the second part, unless you have a specific question around advice. Any other questions that I'm missing?
Well, Dr. Renfro, we have one question here. It says, what is the pharmacy affinity group? What has the pharmacy affinity group accomplished so far?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So really, we've accomplished a decent amount, in my opinion, as chair, for the past 4 years. The first year was really just trying to get the organization up and going, or the affinity group up and going, get the group developed, make sure that pharmacists were aware that SSH existed. So I did a lot of networking with pharmacists that first year. But for after that, we've actively tried to increase the number of presentations at IMSH. We're actually, we're trying to now, we're looking at SimOps. How can we increase the number of pharmacy-specific presentations there. So we've done that. We try to at least have, I think we have three or four pharmacy presentations at each IMSH that we submit. Of course, it's not, it's people from our affinity group. It's not affinity group sponsored, since that's only for sections. But we all get together and submit that. We are also just trying to work and develop webinars to integrate the best practices and show pharmacists, pharmacy educators, how the best practices apply to pharmacy education. And it's not that we're trying to, you know, create a whole new set of best practices, but we're really developing, trying to develop guidance to help pharmacy educators understand how these best practices can best be used in their curriculum. Specifically, we've also, I'm trying to think of other things, we've also been able to make connections with pharmacy educators across the nation. And we've had several, of course, they're not SSH sponsored, but just from the networking that we've had kind of some offshoots of different people working together on specific research projects, writing book chapters, things like that. But while they're not SSH sponsored, they came from us building the pharmacy affinity group. The last thing I'll share is I've had, I don't know how many one-off meetings with directors or other affinity group leaders, SIG leader, section leader. They'll just call me up or they'll ask to schedule a meeting and they'll say, hey, Chelsea, you know, we have this group of pharmacists that want to use our sim center. Do pharmacists use, you know, how are they going to use simulation? And I'll share some things with them or maybe make connections with the different programs that want to have pharmacists, but they don't know of any pharmacy learners in their area. So for the first year, it's really been about increasing the presence of pharmacists, and or not just pharmacists, but all pharmacy educators, and also making those connections moving forward. I know that we're going to have some good people in the leadership for this upcoming year. So I know that we're going to have a lot of great things moving forward coming down the pipeline. Great. Thank you so much for that. So for the second half of the presentation, and I'm still keeping track of time because I want to, you know, leave some time at the end for any more questions that might come from the material that I'm getting ready to present. Or if you're thinking about the first part of the material, kind of that road, that why pharmacy simulation is becoming more and more prevalent in pharmacy education, I wanted to now kind of do the second half of the presentation and focus it on specific simulations or specific considerations whenever you're developing simulation for pharmacy learners, or even just integrating pharmacy learners into your simulation. And like I said, we'll have a whole separate presentation on this. If you are attending SimOps, I'll be there. Actually, our lead simulation operations person will be here. He's actually the co-director of our Sim Center. While we are looking for a new executive director, Jared Young, he'll be coming and presenting with me. We'll also have Les Barta, who is the director for Rutgers College of Pharmacy Simulation Center, and then Jennifer Bill from Samford College of Pharmacy. She'll be here and we'll be talking about how we use pharmacy, some ops considerations for pharmacy. So, but I'm going to talk briefly about some of them. And whenever I was thinking about this, the things that really came to mind most for me, so I kind of put them in five different buckets. The one thing is, especially, and this is a big issue for us, is we haven't, and us by the College of Pharmacy, we have a large class size. I typically have 180 learners in each one of my classes. And then after the first semester, they spread out over three campuses across the state. So I know some sim centers or some colleges, they'll actually bring their students back to campus to participate in any simulations that they have. But that's really hard for us just for the fact that our campuses are, I think the one in Memphis is, if you're on a bus and you're driving the speed limit from our other campus in Knoxville, that's almost 7 hours. It's kind of almost even 7.5, depending on how many stops you take. So it's really not practical for us to be busing everyone into our into CHIPS. So that's something to take into consideration. And if you remember the focus that our standards had on using simulation for assessment purposes, it's hard to get everyone through a simulation. So whenever you have a class in skills-based classes that might just be 2 hours, you sometimes have to think, okay, well, we might need another day a full day devoted to this? You know, are we using standardized patients? Do we need to put in breaks for our standardized patients? It's not a do, it's, you know, where should we? Because of course our standardized patients need breaks. And that's something that is really important to take into consideration when you do have that large class size. At one point we thought, well, maybe we can break it down into two different days. And with that, it came into the consideration of, well, the first class, the first day till the second day, all of the cases. So then we had to develop two cases that were similar enough to meet all the objectives, but then different enough that the learners couldn't communicate the answers to each other. So those are other considerations with large class sizes around summative simulation. But for formative simulation, one thing that we've started using, there are two different methods that we've used. We've used deconstructed small groups. So we'll have an SP come in with about 10 learners, and the SP will have two learners go up and they'll do a little bit of the encounter, and then we'll do a timeout, and we'll have two other people come up, do a little bit more of the encounter. And that's been a way that I've actually got a paper that I'm working on and hopefully going to be having it out soon, is we found that the use of deconstructed small groups as compared to role play with another student, actually it was statistically significant, the increase in their scores on their summative assessment. So that's something that we found with larger classes. A lot of people just say, oh, we'll have them role play with each other. But using these deconstructed small groups has really helped our students and helped prepare them for patient counseling sessions. The other thing we've used is trigger videos. So we'll play a little bit of a pre-recorded video, and then we'll debrief the class on what happened. So those are some things that we've done with large class sizes. Integration of pharmacy management software. So one thing that I found is there wasn't a great software out there. And there's My Dispense. Pioneer has a kind of a demo software you can use. OmniCell is working on one. So there's a lot of different ones out there, but none of them were great for teaching our students how to go above and beyond just filling a prescription. So certain documentation standards. So with that, we really tried to work on, we got a couple different, and I won't go into all the names because I might bore you, and this isn't for CE, so thankfully I can't get in trouble for that. But whenever we would go in and we'd use it, I would have to, since we had a large class size, I would have to build a profile for each student. Or if they used it in groups, we couldn't, you know, one person might take over all the documentation. So there were a lot of considerations when we were integrating the pharmacy management software, but they are out there and they are helpful to especially be thinking about that pharmacist patient care process. Sterile preparation simulations. I'm not going to dive too much into that just for the fact that I'm not the one over all the sterile prep simulations at our school. We do have a separate, we have a technician who does all of that for our students, but there are other considerations that I know Les Bart is really going to be diving into at our talk at the SimOps conference about that. But the main thing is thinking about sharps containers, thinking about how that you would dispose of all the things that students, whenever they're prepping sterile dosage forms, and how could you potentially be green about that? What things can you reuse, and then what things do you need to throw away and definitely not be reusing? Use of demonstration medications. So as I mentioned previously, pharmacy students can be very, very detail oriented. So for the first time we did a patient counseling simulation using enoxaparin. We just had, because we had, you know, 180 students, we had to get through the simulation. So we had a lot of rooms running. So instead of going out and buying demo dose or another, you know, form, I think Practomed might be another one, but instead of buying an actual syringe that looked like enoxaparin, we had our SimOps people put together and tried to create something that looked like enoxaparin to be a little bit cheaper. Well, it didn't have the safety device for whenever they would inject it. So that threw all of our students for a loop. So thinking about those SimOps considerations whenever you're putting together a simulation, you know, are there going to be, you know, are you going to buy the demo medications? Or are you going to try to find something that looks similar, but is it similar enough to have all of the things that the pharmacy student's going to be counseling on? And then lastly, the length of a patient encounter. So I know that some simulations that are done with other professions might be a little bit longer because that's the nature of that encounter with that patient in real life. But a lot of times whenever you're counseling a patient in the community pharmacy setting, you're lucky to get 5 minutes to counsel them. Just because there's so many things going on, you have other people in line, and the patient might not want to sit there for 30 minutes and be counseled. So we tend to have shorter patient encounters that are more for the summative setting. So that's just another thing to keep in mind whenever you are putting together a schedule for pharmacy simulation or working with an educator on how to develop a pharmacy simulation. Let's see. So next, I'm going to give two different examples of how UTHSC has incorporated simulation into the curriculum we have here. And one's going to be focused on pharmacy specific, so it'll just be around pharmacists. And then the other one will be an interprofessional activity that we've developed. So for the first activity I'll be talking about is a simulation that I integrated into one of our skills-based courses in the spring semester for the first year of pharmacy school. So previously when I taught pharmacy students how to counsel to improve medication adherence, I would lecture them on the different types of medication non-adherence. And then we would walk through patient cases. And then we would discuss, you know, why was this patient non-adherent? What could we have recommended? And we started getting feedback from some of our preceptors that pharmacy students couldn't, they're struggling with being able to assess non-adherence and then work with patients to develop specific interventions. And I'm thinking, well, I taught this, you know, what's going on? So we decided to turn this into a simulation to help them apply that knowledge that they were learning. So what we did was we developed a patient phone call simulation. So they, and well, the other comment and the reason why this is a phone call is because we got feedback from our preceptors that our students didn't know how to talk on the phone. And that's because all of our students text on their phone, they don't want to call. So I was like, okay, well, we can set this up. So I worked with our Sim Center and we developed a simulation where students are provided a patient profile. They assess the patient profile and they're going to be calling to do an adherence check. During the phone call, the students need to identify, you know, why is the patient non-adherent? Are there any social determinants of health that might be impacting the adherence? Are there things that they could address now? Are there on the phone call? Are there things that they can still address, but they maybe need to address it with, you know, their preceptor first or work with a technician to do, or are there things that they need to work with other members of the patient's healthcare team on? So with that, here's kind of the flow of how it worked. So students use a rubric to guide reflection on how the simulation, on how to do the, so after the simulation, they use a rubric to kind of guide that self-reflection on how simulated patient encounter went. Then we debrief with the students and we walk through kind of what we observed, what, you know, maybe based on what they did, how might that have impacted the patient? And then we want to take it one step further and discuss how they can take what they learned in that experience on rotations in real life, because this occurs right before they go out on some of their community introductory rotations. The last one I wanted to talk to you all about was an interprofessional education activity that we developed for first year pharmacy students, first year med students, and second year physician assistant students. And it, you know, it is a simulation, but it's kind of more towards that gamification. It was a tabletop escape game. And how this came about is we previously had an activity that wasn't simulation based to teach the students about the role that social determinants of health play medication adherence, but it just wasn't clicking. The students weren't engaging with each other. So we sat down and I had just recently played an escape board game. And I think that some of the faculty that I was working with, whenever I brought it in and I set it down, I was like, we need to do this. So we worked together and we built this big escape game. And I'll share a little bit about that, but the students absolutely loved it. You see them, this is actually a picture of them working together. They're all leaned up, talking to each other, sharing information. It got really competitive at one point because they were all wanting to escape and win the game. So it was very interesting to kind of see whenever we kind of turned it from an activity to using the simulation gamification, how everyone was able to interact together. So for the tabletop escape game, I have the escape game learning goals or the learning objectives here. However, the overall goal of the escape game was to teach students the role that social determinants of health play in medication adherence. And we wanted to make sure that students prior to participating in this game, that they were given, they had a lecture and then some activities on non-adherence. So what is non-adherence? What are different types of non-adherence? And then what are the social determinants of health? So this wasn't, they did have some prior knowledge before coming into this game. So with the game, they had kind of three different steps. So they got their box, and their box had a series of puzzles and challenges that the team had to work together to address the patient's needs. And then by doing all of that, they would escape the game. So they also had to work together. There were some clues that were more focused towards medicine, more focused towards pharmacy. So people couldn't, you know, just sit there and let the physicians do everything or the physician assistants do everything. And the pharmacists needed to kind of pull in their knowledge as well. After they completed the escape game, they had some guided self-reflection. It's really, I guess, more of a group reflection on the activity by answering some questions. And the reason why we did that is because we found that these were novice learners and that they needed a little bit more guidance to be able to reflect on their experience. So we'd ask them, you know, what did you learn? What surprised you? What communication challenges arose? What effective communication strategies did you use to help with those communication challenges? And then how did you work together effectively as a team? And then lastly, we had a facilitated debrief, allowing participants to reflect kind of on their communication skills, teamwork, and then we also wove in the social determinants of health and that impact it had on medication non-adherence. We really, and I know there's different frameworks that you can use for debriefing, and I won't, you know, jump into all those because I know that you all are very familiar about all those, but we kind of did the what, so what, now what. So we wanted to ask them, well, what issues did you uncover while participating in the skateboard game? So they would talk and they would share all those issues and we're like, okay, so what? So now what? Or so what? So did you learn anything as a result of participating in the game? What did you learn about the role of social determinants of health? Did you have any preconceived notions about the other healthcare professions in the group? And then how did you work together to find missing pieces of information? And then lastly, the now what? Because we wanted them to take what they're learning together and be able to implement it in the community setting. So those questions were asked to guide the students to think about how they're going to apply what they learned to taking care of patients on rotations and in the real world, and how might they actually work together in that real world setting. So that's, I think, everything that I had covered. So I have right about 10 minutes to answer any questions that you all have about pharmacy simulation. I tried to put a lot in the presentation. So if I didn't cover something in depth, I'd love to answer a question now or anything that you all think is related to pharmacy simulation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Renfro. I have a few questions here. How do you encourage faculty involvement with simulation at UT to ensure appropriate debrief?
That's a great question. So I will say, so even though I'm over simulation for our college, we still have, we have excellent staff at CHIPS at our Sim Center on campus that they actually have great faculty development trainings to teach our, and they use debriefing with good judgment there. So walk through, you know, how do you appropriately debrief? When we have an interprofessional event, we all sit down and we try to make sure that we're appropriately debriefing together. And CHIPS really helps facilitate that. They also use the DASH tool to help assess our debriefing and provide feedback for us. And I know that's something that not all pharmacy schools have access to. So sometimes what, whenever I'm working with other schools or I've talked to other schools, what they'll do is they'll actually maybe bring someone in to share debriefing strategies or techniques. I have several different grants right now that have simulation as a part of them for a training program for practicing pharmacists. So I have our educators in that, or our trainers that are leading the training program. At that point, since it's not really necessarily for students, CHSE isn't as involved as much, but I'll go through and do trainings for them to help and make sure that they understand how to appropriately debrief. Because that really is, as you all know, where a lot of the learning occurs. But that's something that we also try to make sure all of our pharmacy educators who are involved in debriefing complete that training through CHSE.
Thank you so much. And then we have another one here. Can you share your experience with simulation in the practice setting, and how can pharmacists be involved?
Yeah, no, that's an excellent question. I absolutely love that question. So thank you for asking that. And that's one thing that it's been interesting, the working with practicing pharmacists on simulation, because a lot of times, and as I said, I think whenever I was in pharmacy school, simulation was just getting started. So I was familiar with it, but a lot of pharmacists that graduated before me are not familiar with it. So whenever we share what they're going to be doing, well, you know, we go through the pre-brief, make sure they have an appropriate pre-brief, that they feel comfortable with everything. And they're like, wait, what am I doing? But a lot of times we've been able to we've implemented simulation with practicing pharmacists two different ways. One way, kind of, as I mentioned, we have a couple grants focusing on how to use different communication techniques to improve vaccine hesitancy or decrease vaccine hesitancy in patients who are hesitant to vaccines. So we've done the simulations with pharmacists a couple different ways. We've always used standardized patients. Some of them during the COVID times have been via Zoom, where they'll actually log on, they'll be given the patient profile, and then they'll practice how they would communicate with a patient who is hesitant to getting a vaccine. We've done them in person at our Sim Center, where we actually have a mock pharmacy. I didn't put any pictures on the screen, but we have a mock pharmacy set up. So they'll come in and we try to make it more simulated or more real life. We got a lot of feedback from pharmacists that they wished that it had been in their actual stores. So for our next round, for the next grant we have, we're going to be doing in situ simulation at the pharmacist stores and kind of having, I guess, a road trip going with, to all of these different pharmacies and doing in situ simulation to train them. The other way is we're actually using simulation for continuing education for pharmacists. So in our department for continuing education here at the college, we have several different training programs where you can get CE. And some of that CE is actually through simulation and part of the debrief associated with that. And that's kind of learning, how would you do a medication review? How would you develop a collaborative practice agreement and work with other healthcare professionals? So we've developed simulations in that way to really integrate pharmacists into simulation-based education. So not just students, but it's always pharmacists are taken back at first when we talk about simulation, because it wasn't something that they maybe used during their education.
Thank you so much. And then we do have one last question. It is, do you have recommendations for faculty development resources?
What was the first word? I couldn't hear.
Do you have recommendations for faculty development resources?
Okay, I think I'm going to answer this appropriately. And if I don't, please put it in the chat and I would love to elaborate. So for, do I have accommodations for faculty development resources?
Recommendations.
I thought you said
recommendations. Sorry.
Recommendations. Sorry about that. So that's why I always like to repeat the question if I don't understand. So a lot of times there are, and we have, and like I said, we're very fortunate to have CHSE that makes recordings, but there are, I've looked on several different websites and I can't remember them off the top of my head, but there's a lot of great websites out there that have little quick snippets that go over debriefing with good judgment. There's some out of CMS, out of Harvard, that are very, very great. They're very, very good. There are a couple of great podcasts that I'll sometimes have our faculty listen to and they'll go through, I like the debrief to learn one. I'm pretty sure it's Dr. Adam Chang is the one that leads that one. And then there's, I think it's Simucast. Those are also ones. So I'll sometimes find different podcasts and I'll share those with our faculty who are involved. So those are some resources that you can use. But if you don't have, you know, all the resources like we have at CHIPS or that certain people have at CAMELS, that you can work with people to find some trainings that are free and available out, online.
Thank you so much. As we're approaching the end, I will forward this over to Irini for some closing remarks. Thank you so much for everything, Dr. Renfro.
Thank you for having me. I've really enjoyed it.
Again, I would like to just echo that. Thank you so much, Dr. Renfro, for sharing your background regarding the role of simulation in the academic pharmacy setting. Your perspectives have been very insightful as we implement more simulations within our programs. So thank you. We hope that you'll all join us next month as we come to you live from the SimOps conference to discuss the importance of a diverse healthcare team in simulation operations. Take care, everyone, and have a great week ahead.